I am here with Ryan Frederick, and looking forward to this interview. Ryan, welcome to the show, Experience Talks.
Yeah, thank you for having me, Tim.
All right, here's a little bit about Ryan Frederick, who is an amazing guy I've known for a while. Ryan Frederick is the founder and CEO of Smart Living 360, and he focuses on the intersection of place and healthy aging. His first book, Right Place, Right Time, The Ultimate Guide to Choosing a Home for the Second Half of Life, released just this week from Johns Hopkins University Press. Mine was delivered via Kindle the other night. It's a great book, read it. Smart Living 360 helps institutions and individuals thrive in the age of longevity by providing strategy consulting services, real estate development services, and consumer content. Clients range from leading health systems to billion-dollar institutional investment firms to national real estate developers to senior living providers and others. Smart Living 360 co-developed the Stories at Congressional Plaza, which is an age-friendly apartment community in greater Washington, D.C. that has attracted national attention. You can check out Ryan's blog at smartliving360.com. He serves on the National Advisory Board of the Johns Hopkins University School of Nursing, and he's a fellow for Nexus Insights, a think tank focused on new models of care and community for older adults. Ryan, I'm really excited to have you on the show, and congratulations on the book.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Tim. No, it's my pleasure. I know we've I've enjoyed our conversations in the past. I wish they were more frequent. So it's great to have this opportunity.
To be fixed, that problem. So I want to ask you about the organization. I want to ask you about the book, but I kind of want to start out with your origin story. I always wonder how people get from A to K, or wherever you are in the alphabet of your career. How did you become the expert in place and healthy aging? How'd you get here?
Yeah, well, you know, there wasn't a master plan, Tim. you know, if anything, I did a keynote talk last week and I shared some of this. I had some pictures too, because I had some formative experiences like a number of us do in this broader field of aging. And I was close to my grandparents growing up. My family moved from Virginia to the West Coast. And so our extended family is all east of the Mississippi, but my maternal grandparents would come out and they would house sit a neighbor. And so for about 4 to 6 weeks each month, I got to hang out with my grandparents as if we lived next to each other. And during the summer, there was more kind of hanging out time. So I had some of the benefits of just the spontaneous, informal interactions with my grandparents. I got to my grandfather, you know, in particular, and he was a product of the Greatest Generation. And he, he taught me a lot of lessons about saving money and how things can turn in different ways, but there was a wisdom there. And I enjoyed that interaction. And then at my sixth grade English teacher, she had a passion for music and older adults. And so she created this program where once a month we went over to Lytton Gardens, which was the local assisted living community, we brought our recorders and we got teamed up with a buddy. And my buddy was Melba Rollins. And Melba was healthy other than the fact that she was blind. Otherwise, she didn't have to be in assisted living, but that was the reason she didn't have family close by. So Melba and I met monthly through this program, but then we became buddies and we got to, got to see her through seventh and eighth grade. She made me some gifts along the way, a little squirrel I don't have in front of me right now, but that she made that is better than I could make. And she was, you know, she was blind. And so I don't know, I just felt this like connection. And then high school happened and I studied electrical engineering in college and found myself in Silicon Valley for a couple of VC-backed startups. One went public and like, wow, this business thing it's easy. And then there was a fraudulent activity that happened in our in this software company. It sent some people to jail, and it made me kind of take a step back and say, well, what do I want to do with my life, and who do I want to do it with? And then I went to Stanford Business School, and they like drill it in you. It's like, okay, you know, how are you going to change the world? And I didn't have a good answer for it. But it made me take a step back and realize I was passionate about innovation, passionate about helping people. What's that right intersection? And I thought more and more about like longevity, people living longer, at the time, this goes back about 15 years, not as many people were thinking about this.
And so I
wrote a letter to some senior housing and CEOs in senior housing. I didn't know anyone. I didn't actually care that much about place, ironically. It was more, I just knew there were older people that lived in these communities. And I only one CEO replied. It was the CEO of Sunrise. And he said, I'm happy to have you work for summer. I really can't pay you much. I said, in exchange, can I live in a community for a month? So I lived in a community in Atlanta, Hunt Cliff Summit is what it's called, a little bit north of Atlanta. Couldn't talk my wife into joining me. So I was the only person under 70, only male on my wing. So I got a lot of attention. And you know, today it's what they call design thinking. It's observing and watching and developing empathy through that experience. And I saw that, you know, and Betty Cobb, mentioned her in the book a bit. She was the mayor of this particular community, and she was someone that was perfect, you know, for senior living. But in that whole experience, you know, Tim, I start to ask different questions, which I know we've talked a bit about, like, are we doing this the right way?
Yeah.
And so along this journey, I've worked for investment firms in senior living. I've been worked as a senior executive for one of the largest senior housing companies in the country. I've been on the board of different organizations, for-profit, not-for-profit, you know, a number of things. I'm a developer, do strategy consulting, hands a lot of things. But as I got into this, found myself like passionate about how can we impact people's lives, but also recognizing that some of what we do today or the we provide as a society, it isn't necessarily the best options. Also saw along the way that people don't necessarily fully understand how significant place is in living, you know, a long, healthy life. And that's led to this, you know, this path, non-linear path.
It's great. I love the story that you actually lived in a senior living place when you're at Stanford Business School. It's such a, I love that story. It's talk about learning how places work is living inside of it. And
oh yeah. When people didn't know what to do with, like, my classmates, they're like, you're doing what? I was like just off, you know, off in the hinterland. But yeah, it was, I'm so grateful for that experience because also a time in life where you could do that.
Yeah.
Now and kids in the picture, all those things get more complicated.
That's true. So you're the founder and CEO of Smart Living 360. Can you talk about what the organization is, what it does, and what your goal is with the work, Ryan?
Yeah. So I, similar to the story to share with you, I find myself an innovator in a field that sometimes reluctantly wants to innovate.
Yeah.
And so there's a few different hats I wear as part of Smart Living 360, and it's evolving too. This book has a part of a new direction as well. So really three pieces, Tim. One piece is on the strategy consulting side. So I work with CEOs, executive teams, boards, for-profit, not-for-profit organizations, institutional investment firms, developers, operators, often typically around 6 months, often where we sit down and do a pretty deep understanding of where is our society, where's the industry, where's the organization, and make sure that there's a chance to really align what the organization does in a way that helps the organization thrive. And I find that, especially coming out of the pandemic, it's been so crazy for different organizations. They haven't had a chance to take a deep breath and just think, where are things headed? How can we set up an organization to have an impact and be sustainable? So that's big chunk what I do, and I bring in different people depending on different projects. And then part of that time too is on the development side. So how can we develop, you know, new models? And there was a development had a couple of years ago now in the DC area where really pushed back on this idea. Do we have to create age-restricted environments? And is there a way that we can make conventional environments just better for people of all ages? So what if we just found a way to make normal apartments be truly age friendly for people? So yeah, partnered with a public investment and development firm, Federal Realty, and we in a walkable mixed use area. We developed a project called the Stories at Congressional Plaza, and we made sure through the design that it worked for people of all ages, a lot of universal design principles. And at the same time, you know, we spent a lot of time thinking about how people were socially isolated and lonely before the pandemic. And we talked about what could we do to create this sense of community when you come in, even signal, hey, we're going to be in a part of a building where you get a chance to know your neighbor. And we're going to make it, because it's available for people of all ages, we're going to also be intentional about connecting people across ages. So how can we find ways to, and we have some neat stories actually about some mentoring, and one story in particular where there was an older resident who'd retired, was a French teacher. And then we had a young family homeschooling two kids that were learning French, but needed some help. So our lifestyle ambassador helps create this culture of interconnectedness. He connected them. And what started off as technically some opportunities to learn French and provide purpose, a bit more purpose for our older resident, like really became this intergenerational friendship. And it's like right there, we're all under the same roof, but sometimes it takes a little bit of prodding. Yeah, for these things to come together. And then also part of the model is how can we use technology and coordinate services for people so that as your needs may change, it doesn't necessarily require a change in place. So how do we create new models that we can then scale? And then the third piece is on the consumer side now. And it's been thought leadership in general, but it's really more consumer. I started a blog a few years ago around this project when it first happened. I sort of started thinking about it and I just kept with it. And that blog really is what led to this book, Right Place, Right Time. And so now I'm realizing that there are a lot of people that don't necessarily think as deeply about place as they probably should.
Yeah.
And how can create some content to help people be more intentional about it so they can just make better informed decisions. So the way I sometimes think about it is part of my time is related to supply. How can we create better places or make existing places better? And the other side is on the demand. How can we, like, people and their families and so on, make better decisions around this? And if there's a way that I can impact both in a meaningful way, I'd be, you know, just really excited about that.
That's great. I remember when the Stories at Congressional Plaza came online, and it was like this kind of little neutron bomb that went off. It was such a cool thing. And I love the concept that you designed into it, where you talked about the fact that you actually design connection into the place and the way people were oriented, and the idea of, like, exactly what you said, how do you prod people into connecting socially, giving reasons for people to connect with each other. I thought that was really, really cool and innovative.
Yeah. And well, I think it's it's hard, Tim, because in the day-to-day realities of how our world functions, particularly in the real estate development world, people they just want to punch things out.
Yeah,
and let's not ask any questions that might, like, slow something down.
Yeah.
And we sadly, I think oftentimes we end up creating buildings, not communities. Yep. And often when investors, look at these apartment buildings, for example, that they're developing, that return profile, that investment summary just captures financial capital. It doesn't capture social capital.
Yeah.
And I think that, increasingly, though it's lower than it needs to be, increasingly, I think there's more people recognizing that, like, good social capital, places where we can create that social fabric, actually has a relationship with financial returns. Because if people come in and they see it as their home, yep, and they're willing and able to invest in building their own sense of community there, it's harder for them to want to leave and get this benefit of longer, tenured residence, which is a key part of the business model too. So as we think about these new models, like, how can we find ways that we're creating communities, not buildings, but that means we have to be creative about how to think about it and then create it. And then ultimately, even the set of investors and capital structure you have, I think, is important to make it all work.
It's great. So let's talk about the book. It just came out, Right Place, Right Time, The Ultimate Guide for Choosing a Home for the Second Half of Life. You mentioned that the blog kind of led to it, but what was the inspiration? Writing a book's not easy. Unless it was for you, maybe it's rarely easy for anyone.
No, it wasn't.
What inspired you to do this now, to take this?
Well, it's dripping in irony, Tim, because I have a daughter right now. In fact, today she took the PSAT. She's a junior. And when I took the PSAT, math was fine, but the English suggested I was English as a second language learner. So my path at that point was to read as much as possible and learn these words that I didn't know so I could get into college.
Yep.
And then avoid reading and writing as much as possible, which is part of what sent me into electrical engineering in college. So this was a book was never part of, the bucket list, no, at all, not interested. And it wasn't aligned with my giftedness. But then I found that this passion around what we're talking about overtook me. And so I started writing this blog because I wanted the people to understand why place mattered. And it was a struggle. It's always been a struggle, but I enjoyed it. And I got some positive feedback. It's like, hey, Ryan, help me think about this differently or more deeply. And then I have a brother-in-law who is an author, and he started, needling me. And it's like, oh gosh, every time I saw him on a family vacation, here we go again. And so he started to demystify some of the experience. When we were leasing up at the Stories at Congressional Plaza, Tim, one thing that I found, we created this whole room where we talked about the facts around successful aging, some of the statistics around it, and helping people engage in why place mattered. I was naive. I assumed that people had read some of the stuff that I had read, but instead most people, just me getting connected to where people were, they weren't aware of the fact that your genetics only account for about 30% of your longevity. They weren't aware of the impact of purpose on your health and well-being and social connection and physical activity and so on. And so it became this kind of aha that it's timely, it takes time, it's expensive to educate people on a one-on-one basis. Even if you have these new models like you do and I've worked on as well, is there a way to go upstream and have something that could be more easily universally shared?
Yeah.
And that's this, it was kind of an organic thing over time. Probably my brother-in-law broke me down ultimately and then got on the path. And then, Paul Irving, he was kind enough to write the foreword, and a number of people that gave some important kind of river guide advice along the way. And so that created the motivation. And then, once I had an agent and then Hopkins Press signed an agreement for that, then I was in, I guess I had to go do this.
Then you actually had to write it.
Then I had to write it. Yeah, totally. And there were good days and there were bad days.
Yeah, I bet. It's such an interesting time for this book to come out too, because obviously, Paul Irving and his intro said, I was so happy. Brian said, I'm going to write a book about this. And then the pandemic hit, which is might be the most said phrase other than you're on mute is, and then the pandemic struck. But having this book released as we're coming out of this thing and all of the ways it's been this huge shifting point in the way people think about place and work and their lives and what do we do with this thing. It's such an interesting time for it to come out. I would imagine that's got to be an exciting thing for you, because that had to be a major part of what you were thinking about.
It was, what happened initially was a little bit of like, oh no, because I had written some of the book before the pandemic hit. But at least in the lens of writing, it was like, oh no, I got to rethink this. However, just like you described, I think there's been awful things about the pandemic for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
However, it's created like a resorting for us. It's forced a set of questions that we often don't ask ourselves in the day-to-day grind of just living a day. We're just trying to just make it through the day most times.
Yep.
And I think with the pandemic, it forced all of us, you know, we were, you and I were talking about this before we started the recording, like we now have had more of an invitation and opportunity to say no to certain things. Does it align with kind of who I want to be? And so I think it is timely. I think it's timely because place was important all the time.
Yep.
But now we got the spotlight on place. And it meant that, you know, if you were in a good spot, maybe you planned well, a few things happened, you were in better shape to, it wasn't great, but you were able to weather the pandemic. If you were in the wrong place, you were at risk health-wise, you're socially isolated. Some really bad things happened. And some of that's randomness, but there is something about having a plan, thinking about it versus not. And I think that, so we've had this experience where a lot of the wounds are still fresh, either directly or indirectly. But now, as you point out with work and these other variables, there's more free variables than there's been in the past. And so we can ask ourselves these questions, am I in the right place for where I am?
Yeah.
And then also this question around, I think sometimes people just assume you're in the right place forever. This is where I'm going to be. And I think that also, this is providing an opportunity to ask those set of questions too. Maybe I should challenge that assumption. Maybe I've been here for a long time in this house or region or whatever. Is this really the right place for me?
Yeah.
In light of things. And so I think it's created an invitation for us to ask a different set of questions and to be really thoughtful about them.
It's also another thing about the book that I see is it's one of those things where I always have people say, you know, that's a great idea you had. Why didn't somebody think about that before? This book just seems like the most obvious example of that I've ever seen, because how many people do you know that actually are prepared to go into what happens after you get older? It's usually some catastrophic event somebody needs to move mom because of this, or somebody dies. It's all of these things. And then all of a sudden somebody is up against the wall about what to do with mom or dad, and no one's planned for it. So the idea that there's a book about, you know, maybe we should be thinking about this way in advance of that, for one thing. But also, I assume with this book, you're not really, it's not just for older people. It's also about how do you decide around place and life and health and all of those things that everybody should be thinking about.
They totally should. And Tim, you know, I'm so enjoying this conversation, because part of what happened is my background is on the aging side. But as I got into the different principles about how to think about this, it's age independent.
Yeah.
And I do know, I mean, we have kids, they're teenagers right now, and we recently moved from Mid-Atlantic to Texas. And no doubt the school district had a key influence in our decision making. Once you take kids out of the equation, however, a lot of variables become free to you.
Yeah, especially as they start going to college and stuff, you know, I mean, planning for empty nests and
What does that look like? And now with people living longer, you know, they say that half the kids born today in the developed world are going to live to 100 or more.
Yeah.
And if you're educated with some resources, in the pandemic's going to be a blip, I think, over this longer term trend. And so you might find your kids gone and you might be living for many decades longer. And then what do you want that to look like? And that, I think that's part of it, is that you're right. Like, how it starts out, I think, with a bit of a vision of what do you want these different chapters to look like? And then how does place enable that? And I think that I know a number of people, it's come up actually even in some of my conversations this week related to the book launch, is that I think people sometimes are seeing what happened to their parents. And they're saying, you know, I don't necessarily want to, they didn't plan. I don't want to do that.
And so
I think that there's a younger generation right now in their 50s, 60s, whatever, where they're looking at this and saying, you know what, I got to do this differently. So, I was surprised when I was thinking about this. There are some books out there and resources that are very tactical. Here's your checklist. And it may or may not be comprehensive, but it's very tactical. There's really nothing out there right now that allows people to take a step back, like allows them to dream, grab a coffee, grab a glass of wine, whatever it is, and say, what do I want this to look like? But then have some opportunities to tactically, you know, do things about it.
That's one of the things I love about the book, because you combine kind of a somewhat of a linear path to, these are the things that you should think about, you know, here's where you start, and here are some things that you should think about in terms of as you get older. But then you also pepper it with stories. I mean, you do that. I've seen you speak, I've talked to you a lot. You know, the idea that you make it about real people making real decisions, and then what happens, is a really fantastic way to do it. Was that hard for you to find and choose the stories of the people that you chose to illustrate your points?
Yeah, well, I, you know, there are these people that have an impact on you, and but you've never met them. Sometimes that happens with like historical figures. You know, for me, when I first started like watching or listening to and then reading some of Atul Gawande's articles.
Yeah.
Wow, this guy is a gifted, brilliant. And he's a gifted communicator. And then when he wrote his book, Being Mortal, it's like, how in the world do you have a book that's about end of life? And there's like 15,000 five-star reviews. Like, how's that happen? Well, it happens. Yeah, he's gifted. He's a brilliant communicator. But also has, it's very much an overarching story.
Yep.
His experience with his dad. And I didn't have an overarching story that would fit in the framework what I was trying to get to. But I felt it was really important to get real stories in there that people could relate to, they could identify with along the way, and also just, you know, sharing some of my stories too, you know, where it made sense. So it my goal was to make it readable, you know, that you'd sit down and you wouldn't, you know, it's not an academic book, it's not a book of checklists. It's like, hey, let me just flip through this and provoke some thinking. And then where do I want to fit on this journey?
Yeah.
And so that's why I do think that, I mean, there may be even people in their 30s that look at this that are maybe advanced planners, and they look at this, hey, wait a second, there's just some things I should be thinking about if I'm picking a spot to get rooted in. So, but it was hard to pick out some of the stories. I know an initial version I had, I want to say like 12 vignettes, and that was cumbersome, so teased it down to 5. But that, there was a lot in that, like getting the stories and making it relatable to a wide number of people.
Can you talk about maybe one or two of the principles of place for just to give examples of to people? I mean, I know you mentioned Dan Buettner's work with the Blue Zones. I mean, I know there is some stuff that bubbles up in terms of what people should have in place. But I also, I don't think it's limited, again, to older people.
And not at all.
Dan's never talked about it being about older people. It's about studying why people are successful at getting older, and everybody should just do that, right?
Yeah, no, totally. And I think that's part of it. Like, I think we can think of it in the context of longevity. Like, how does place impact longevity? And I think two things I would say. One, I think sometimes place, we think about it too narrowly. We think about place in terms of my physical dwelling, my single family house, my apartment, my condo, my duplex. And that's a component of place. But place is also what neighborhood you're in. What street are you on? What metropolitan area? Is it rural, suburban? Urban, what region of the country, even what country are you in? I think it's a broader composite, you know, with all the sadness that's come out of Afghanistan recently. You could have a beautiful house in Afghanistan, but that's probably a pretty awful place to be right now. It's just one kind of extreme example. So I think it starts off with saying, like, how do we think about place? Is our definition broad enough in this way? And then those principles, I think Dan has done some great work with Blue Zones as examples of what's out there. There's also a ton of research, though, that look at purpose on its own, that look at social connection on its own, that look at, you know, physical well-being on its own. And so I think the right place, it's not just the framework I talked about, it's also how does it impact these key elements of your life. Because as I said earlier, you know, it's genetics only account for about 30% of your longevity. So it's really more about like lifestyle and environment. So are you in a place at any age where you have purpose that's greater than yourself?
Yeah.
You know, are you, do you have that social fabric, whether you're an introvert or extroverted? Do you have these relationships that matter as it plays out? People, I did this talk last week, and 30 years ago, you know, there were about three times as many people that had 10 or more, like they would say close friends than they do today. There's five times as many people have no close friends outside of their immediate family. You know, so we have these societal dynamics right now, and certain places can then, you know, make it easier to have those social connections than others. So I look at it, in the lens of around purpose, social connection, physical well-being, financial well-being for a long life. And then, so place influences that, but also place itself has certain dimensions. Like if you're, if mobility is a concern or a future concern, maybe having a three-story house, you know, isn't a great idea. Or if you want to be in a spot where you want to be walkable to things and, you know, you're at the top of a hill, you know, far away from, that's hard. So there are specific things around place itself, beyond just influencing these other elements that needs to be thought through too.
Yeah. I had in my notes that you practice what you preach by moving from the Mid-Atlantic to Austin during a pandemic with some teenagers in the house. You actually, I think in our discussion before, called it eating your own dog food, which I'm going to steal. Yes. I like that better now. But there's also a story in your book about a couple that moves to Tyler, Texas, and there's some really specific reasons why they did that and why that was successful. Can you kind of just give, you know, a bit of a teaser on that story? Is, I thought that one was really impactful.
Yeah. So this is in the conclusion, and I know with books, people are more likely to make the introduction than the conclusion. But for readers that do get a chance to pick up the book, I do encourage you to get to the conclusion, because part of what I grappled with in thinking around this, Tim, and the writing is there, you know, there's times when a move away from your region or metropolitan area is the right thing. And the book, by the way, it doesn't pass judgment. It just lays out, here are things to think about, and then you pick, you know, your path. It's best that you're honest with what matters to you and your loved ones, so you live your life, not, you know, someone else's. In the case of Fred and Carol Smith there in the conclusion, you know, they made this decision decades ago to move to Tyler, Texas. And Tyler is, some might call, a distant suburb of Dallas, but it's its own, you know, city at this point. Yeah. And they made this decision years ago when they had young kids that, We're going to be a sticker, in the words of Wendell Berry. There's boomers and there's stickers. Boomers, people move to the next boom. Stickers, doesn't matter what, they stay there. They're part of the social fabric. And so, you know, with Fred and Carol, they made this decision, you know, decades ago. And as a result, they've just invested in their local community. So they have really diverse set of friends. You know, their house works for now. If in fact the house needs to change, they're not leaving Tyler. They'll just change a different physical dwelling. And so the richness that they've been able to have over these years, it's really powerful. And one of the things I encourage people in the book as well is that because we're living longer, you know, I mean, I'm originally from the San Francisco Bay Area. You know, we lived in Baltimore for nearly a decade. We're here in Austin for 2 years. You can move somewhere in the second half of life and be rooted there. It doesn't have to be, you know, your hometown, wherever that is.
Yeah.
And particularly when it comes to the social fabric piece, you just don't like snap your fingers and it's created. These are investments in finding your people, your place. And so I think that, I think there is a bit of a call to considering what would it be to be rooted for the long haul in a particular location.
Yeah, I love the way Wendell Berry talks about the fact that we not only have to choose a place, it also has to choose us to a certain extent too. Yeah. That it has to link us to it. And I think that, you know, it's another important book part of the book and raised by you in your in talks that I've seen you give is that it's also not necessarily a permanent decision when you move. I mean, I think that there's this mythology that when we move older adults that, God, don't move them again because it's so hard to move. And I've never really understood that. It's like, you know, you have to choose a place for your parents or you have to choose a place to go to that might be a retirement place and then it's forever. I like the fact that you address that and that and demystify the fact that nothing is forever anymore when you live to potentially 100 years old, as you said.
Yeah, and that's, you know, where the title came from too. It's like right place, right time. So it means that there's this evaluation that we're best doing. Sometimes it happens during transition points. Maybe, yeah, you've left your job of many years, or maybe there's a health condition that changed, or maybe, you know, life takes you to a different direction. Like there's some natural transitions that ask this question, like, what about place? Should place change as well? And on average, people move more than a dozen times in their life.
Yeah.
So there is an element of having it be a core competency, or at a minimum, considering like, what would it look like if you moved? I was on a talk show earlier today, and this one woman I spoke with, she talked about how she's a bit stuck. She's like, I'm here, my father living with me. I don't, is this all that's there? And I said, well, actually that may be the best path for you, but it may not be. Like, let's open our minds for what are other possibilities?
Yeah.
And I think it's so important when we're in this to say, well, what are other possibilities? Because it helps you honestly evaluate whether where you are really is the right place. I think it comes up pretty often in the you know, aging in place perspective, which I do have a little bit of a rant on in the book in terms of terminology and its use. I think sometimes people say, I want to age in place, but they haven't really thought through what are potentially the trade-offs of that outcome.
Yeah.
And it's, I think, even if that is what you do along the way, I think it's important to prompt yourself, well, maybe I am ageless, but do I even know my neighbors anymore? And, you know, is it financially the right thing for me? A bunch of different things. And the book goes through some questions to sort that out.
Yeah. Yeah. You and I have talked about aging in place, I think. And I think it's one of those phrases that was coined too early and might be the wrong combination of words.
It's the wrong combination.
Sounds like canned fruit to me.
It does.
It's like, I think the idea of aging safely is nice, but you know, aging in place sounds like being stuck to me.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I suggest, I'm not, you know, I know it's hard. I suggest at least living in community.
Yeah.
It's suggestive of a more proactive and healthier framework, even if that, in fact, that means you stay in the same physical dwelling for a long time.
Yeah. One of the things I want to talk to you about is when people use this book as a guide, when they need to help their aging parents or their mom or dad, and they're in that place where they need to find a place. What are some of the things that you've learned about senior living and how people handle that transition that you can help people with? And I mean, I know it's discussed in the book quite a bit, that seems to be like a really scary place where people tend to land very often.
Yeah,
and then what do we need to change about senior living? I love the fact that you've become this instigator, you know, troublemaker, like, and please continue to go forth and prosper with that, because I do agree we do some things right, we do some things really not so great either.
I did a TED-like talk at one of these industry conferences a number of years ago, and they want to have a mix of what they call industry insiders and then innovators outside the field. And so they invited me to do it. I said, I'm just curious, where do I fit? And he's like, they're like, Ryan, we struggled with that because technically you're an insider, but you're really like this innovator, really probing thing. So I enjoy the role for the most part. A few things to answer. I think that part of what we struggle with, Tim, is that people, they don't want to think about it, but they don't want to think about it. And because they want to think about it and there's not a plan and they don't see the optimism. And part of what I argue for in the book is that actually there is this thing called the U-shaped happiness curve. People objectively across the world, they're happier in their 70s and 80s than they were at any point in their life. And, you know, start off in your 20s, you go down somewhat precipitously until your late 40s, early 50s. I like to think it has something to do with teenagers. And then you work your way up there. And so that part of that narrative, we don't hear that in our ageist society.
Yeah.
And so what it means is if I picked some of the right places, actually, these truly can be golden years if I'm thoughtful about it. So I think that that narrative helps because it says I shouldn't necessarily fear tomorrow. Yeah. Tomorrow might bring some great things. Maybe it's an opportunity for me to hold my great grandchild or whatever, you know, enjoying these different milestones for me, but others around me that I care for. So I think there's this lack of thinking about it. I think that it's confusing. I think senior living is certainly confusing today. I think that there's this fear as well that that I'm going to be like placed somewhere by my kids. And so, you know, when I wrote the book, I was pretty careful because I wanted to have it be easy to the ears or eyes, I suppose, for both, I'll call older adults, people in their 70s, 80s, let's say, but also make it readable for adult children, for their thinking about their parents, but also for themselves, and have it be an invitation for a set of conversations that would be less about where am I putting mom or dad, but more like, well, what do we want this to look like? What do we want it to look like? And not to be naive about some of the challenges that can and will occur for people, yeah. but recognize, hey, if we don't kind of get into this the right way, then we find ourselves instead in this urgent situation where where our options are much narrower. And likely the outcomes are worse. So I think part of it is changing the narrative of the conversation, creating an invitation for that conversation. The chapter on senior living, ironically, was probably the hardest chapter for me to write.
Yeah, I bet.
Because I knew too much. And so some people were kind enough to like tear it apart for me. And so I tried to then, you know, help people understand the bigger picture of what the different, you know, different pieces are. But I also, mention that we are accelerated a bit with the pandemic, with now technology that's available and healthcare services. There's more and more that can be done now for people to stay outside of senior living if that's a desire. And I think that's also an opportunity for senior living to, and I'm sure stuff you think a lot about, how can senior living, however defined, be even more compelling for people. So they say, no, that is what I want. That's what I want to choose, not be forcibly moved into. One other tactical thing that we know, but I think the book helped me hit me on the head a little bit harder, was that sense of home and belonging. And if adult children, you know, my parents are in the mid to late 70s, if I come to my parents and say, okay, guys, figure it all out. Here's where you're going. I'm likely to get a different response and they're likely to have a different experience than instead it's a shared conversation, a conversation that lead where they choose.
And
I think sometimes we get in the situation where I rationally get, I'm an engineer by training. Hopefully my horizons have expanded a bit, but sometimes we can get in this rational thinking, well, this is the best thing for them. This is the best financial decision. And then in that process, like we miss the person.
Yeah, it's a bit ageist and disrespectful because you're leaving them out of the equation and they're the ones who own it.
It's their home. Yeah. And it's a physical place, but that's a feeling. That's an emotion as well.
Yeah. Yeah. I love the way you connect ageism with these ideas too, because, you know, at the core of it, the fear thing comes from the fact that as a country, we suck at this. You know, we're the worst. We make it sound all doom and gloom and everything. And obviously there are some real serious issues that we're going to be faced with. But the core thing that we've got to attack is that age is something wrong that we need to fix and not an opportunity that could be the greatest thing that ever happened to everybody in a community. You know, the neighborhood piece of it that you talked about so eloquently in the book, for me, the pandemic has pointed out, you know, the most important thing that we need to do is get to know the people who live close to us. We need to create community in neighborhoods and remember how to help each other all the time, not just when it hits the fan.
Yeah, you know, we're fortunate. We've got you know, we moved from Baltimore a couple of years ago. We bought a house and then we remodeled. Haven't remodeled anything before. That was an adventure. But we happen to have some great neighbors.
Yeah.
And I just gave the book to one of our neighbors and you know, signed it for them. And I didn't say this directly, but it was implied. Had I known about them beforehand, you know, we would have paid more for the house. Like it makes a difference who your neighbors are. In fact, with Fred and Carol, the story earlier about Tyler, Texas, they picked Tyler, but then they moved another time. And they knew the community so well, they knew exactly what street they wanted to live on.
Yeah.
And so I think that, there's these pieces around like neighborliness and social connection that sometimes it's right in front of us, but we need to recognize like how significant it is ultimately in our decisions. You know, Zillow doesn't capture this. We can fall in love with Zillow's pictures, but oftentimes it may not even tell us the most important part of the story.
That, there's your next innovation, man. Go after, you know, Zillow plus psychographic stuff.
Yes. So,
because I think that is, you know, and I think, you know, it's hard work to find that, but I think that's the key to this stuff is to try and find ways where we find people who are like-minded and have the same intent and values as we do, and then everything prospers when that happens.
Yeah, and I struggle with that question, Tim, because you've got where I netted out on it. I couldn't find any great research on this when I was doing my diligence, but I feel like if you're in a spot where you don't share any commonalities, like that's a tough situation. I have one friend that's recently moved from Wisconsin to California because politically she found herself in a spot where it was just no connection.
Yeah.
On the other hand, if you're in a spot where everyone like thinks the same way, then I think that there's a downside to that as well. And there can be like a NIMBYism that comes with that. So how can you find at least enough so you find your people there, so you find your community, but yet, you know, you're not a bubble. And that's a challenge, but I think that's also part of the questions people need to ask. As I said in the book, I don't pass judgment, you know, in the book, it's find your right path, but understand what variables matter. Ask the right set of questions. When you're doing your work, we hosted an event the other day at our house, and it was a woman that had moved from Dallas to Austin to be closer to family, and they love their house, but they think they moved in the wrong neighborhood.
Yeah.
And she's like, I wish I knew about your book. And I said, it wasn't even available when you made the decision. But but it does, like, what are these set of questions when you make these bigger decisions that you should sort out?
Yeah. You think the stories at Congressional Plaza is intergenerational, you know, people being together and connecting across generations, you know, Age Friendly has quite a bit of that. That's a direction we're moving in, you know, creating communities for all ages where people, you know, it's not age segregated. We create connectivity around people. You had a bit of that with your book, I guess, because didn't your daughter help you talk about your teenage kids, but I think your daughter might've helped you with the editing a bit.
Yeah. So I, you know, I was trying to, so as an entrepreneur and you got, you know, kids there, I like opportunities to demystify how like life works.
Yeah.
And my daughter, so three kids, a daughter and two sons, she's a pretty voracious reader and she's a thinker and she writes. And I said, wait a second. She's been editing my blogs for a number of years now. So I said, wait a second. You know, let's put her to work. And so I officially hired her as the editor of the first, you know, complete draft. And she did an awesome job. She did an awesome job. In fact, I think part of it was she was motivated. She didn't mind making her dad's pages bleed. But it was funny because then when I handed the manuscript to the editor at Hopkins Press, one of the comments was, this is one of the cleanest manuscripts we've received in recent memory. You know, you do a lot of the hard work. So, but it was helpful. It created this intergenerational, and she jokes now, she's like, I know way more about longevity and healthy aging than anyone my age, Dad.
That's fantastic. I guess that's a pretty good outcome for a teenager too, is if they're, is the way they act out against their parent is to really brutally edit them. It's a lot better than some of the alternatives, I guess.
Right? Yes, yes. I've channeled her energies.
So the timing of the book, you and I talked about this, you know, the timing coming out of the pandemic and I mean, I think it is right place, right time for the book. What's your overall goal with the book? What's your hope for this? You know, what's your call to action to?
Yeah. So I think, you know, it's been an adventure, Tim. You know, again, the master plan never involved the book, and one thing leads to another, and here you are. I think there's too many things that come to mind right now, Tim. I think one is, and I'm biased, you know, having lived in this thing for so long. I have yet to read the physical copy. I need, it's got a little PTSD, but I do think that it provides a framework and readability that I think could be helpful for a lot of people. And I think that there isn't something out there right now. And so I think it has the prospect of being like the default resource for people that, you know, want to grab a cup of coffee or a glass of wine and work their way through thinking about how a longer life can be a really good thing for them if they make a set of, you know, in good investments. So I'm hopeful that the book in its own right has the ability to influence in a positive way that more people plan for this. And it becomes something that's, yeah, recommended or used in reading groups or however it might take itself.
Yeah,
that's one thing. Same thing that's happened in terms of the outcome is I'm realizing that there's a lot to process. So I'm changing the Smart Living 360 website, change some of it, more to come, where the website heretofore has been maybe 60% consumer, 40%. More business to business. It's really going to be more 95% consumer, and I'll be adding more tools for people. So sure, you can wade through the book, and but there may be some other ways to help prompt some thinking around this. And so the website, it's smartliving360.com, and now you can go on there. I'm changing. I've been doing this monthly blog for a while. I'm going to change the frequency so it's more of a weekly-ish kind of message, but has more practical tools and tips and ideas about how do we make the most of this longer life. Place will be an element for sure, but it'll be other stuff too. And so I'm hopeful that there could be ways that other ways to engage for people to be influential in that journey.
Yeah. In terms of housing and how it connects to place, are there things that we should be doing as a society to try and do that differently, not just from the senior living aspect, but overall? It seems like we have a serious problem with not enough people having a place to live and the right types of places to live. And, you know, there seems to be a lot of barriers there. Do you have any ideas along that line?
Well, and some of the biggest barriers are, you know, closer where you live in terms of some of these amazing, but, you know, high cost areas. It's a great question. And it does speak to a little bit of the Pandora's box that this book is, because on the surface, it's for people in the second half of life, but it introduces a lot of concepts that impact people more broadly. And so I didn't necessarily write it for developers and policy makers. I do think that there's potentially two birds with one stone here, because you can see people reading it personally, but having professional implications in their jobs. So, in fact, I did an article came out this week related to this in a magazine, which is like, what should the future of housing really look like? And I think part of it, a number of things to respond to. I think part of it is we need to be more open to loosening some of the regulations and zoning restrictions, so we can have places that are more than single family housing. So we can make duplexes, quadplexes, we can make it easier for accessible dwelling units to come behind us. So we have what some people call that middle housing. So it's not just a single family home or a high density apartment building? How can we create that in between? And the in between creates more supply, creates different price points. Some of that middle housing also allows for easier sense of community as it happens. At the same time, when we do develop some of this, well, can we find ways to design it so it is age friendly? So we are thoughtful about how the bathrooms are configured and what's used and with the doorway. I mean, I know through the stories that you can do, and I'm sure you've done the same thing. Like, I haven't had a chance to visit your communities, but I'm sure, you know, we know you can create attractive contemporary buildings that are also age friendly. And sometimes it's a limitation mindset for the developer. It's not necessarily a cost issue. So that's another area. I think that there clearly is an area around cost. And how can we find ways to reduce cost? Some of it's related to the impact fees and things that sometimes gets added, but sometimes it is, you know, cost of construction. Sometimes it's maybe there are ways for us to build things in a more manufactured way that cuts down costs and risk in different ways. And some of it even, you know, Tim, is then thinking about maybe I should move to a different place. Where the cost of housing
of living in my life is less.
You know, I've been curious, some of these manufactured home communities, I mean, they can have $100,000 home that is built quite well. And have it be embedded in a community. It doesn't have to be age restricted. It has some of these elements, but you have your private space, but there's community associated with it. So I think part of my answer too is, can we just find ways to create new models too? That allow people a set of options, you know, for them to consider and think about. So there's a lot there as a society we need to work through. Might even be some capital innovations too. You know, I know in your work in affordable housing, those structures are complicated, you know, to pull together. It'd be great if there was ways to streamline some of that process. I know that I mentioned this in the book. I mean, sometimes in the real estate world, you have a set of investors they're expensive investors, and they need to then have their position sold at stabilization. And sometimes what that can create is turnover in the management companies, even the quality of stuff that's built, because they see it as a short-term investment. I wonder if there's some structures that would allow like longer-term investors over a longer horizon to be participate. And then one last thing, because you got me going here, is that, you know, there's also some of these models around co-housing or co-living, and then even something as mundane as roommate sharing. Like, you know, you might be in a larger house. Maybe you should think about, what if I had a roommate or two here that helped defer my costs and the process?
Another great intergenerational idea.
Right.
You know, younger people who can't afford to live in areas and older people who have homes and need help. But, you know, that kind of roommate sharing across generations is growing hugely.
Yeah, and I highlight that in the book. Some are hard, and no doubt some are hard solutions, but some of the answers are like, you know, hiding in plain sight.
Yeah, I love the idea that what you talk about is a range of choices, and then that checks that box you were talking about earlier, where people have choices. You know, they don't feel like I either age in place here or I go into a senior living place and ultimately end up in a nursing home. But, you know, those aren't terrific. That's not a terrific array of choices for someone, the rest of someone's life.
Totally. And I think, you know, we're too close to it in some ways. I think for the layman person, it's the house I'm in or it's skilled nursing. I think sometimes senior living gets all bumped into what, and I think with the headlines that happened during the pandemic, it's probably worse now, that association. And so, right. I mean, I think hopefully that was one of the things about the book is, like, hold on a second. There's actually way more, and there's a lot more coming as it plays out, and just choose wisely.
Yeah. Well, this has been fantastic. I enjoyed this immensely. Major congratulations. Your first book came out this week, man. Congratulations. You should be very, very happy. Right place, right time. Everybody should read this book. It's a fantastic book. Ryan Frederick, thank you very much for being on Experience Talks, and looking forward to more conversations with you, my friend.
Yeah, my pleasure, Tim. I'm just so inspired with all that you do.
You too. All right. Thank you, everybody. Ryan, take care. Enjoy the rest of the book tour. I know you got a lot of stuff coming up. So
thanks so much.
Deep breaths.
Yeah. Thanks, Tim.
Take care, everybody.